So in the today's class, we will be starting with the concept of rent. Now, what is the meaning of rent? Economists use the term rent in a narrow sense. They use the term economic rent, that part of the payment which is made for the use of land only. It is defined as the price paid for the use of land and other natural resources which are completely fixed in total supply. It is the unique supply conditions of land and other natural resources. They are fixed supply which makes rental payments distinguishable from wages, interest and profit payments. There are three theories of rent. Ricardian theory of rent, also known as classical theory of rent. In this theory, rent is treated as a differential surplus accruing to land alone. So, what do you mean by rent? Rent is the use of land, natural resources, which are fixed to the fixed with the total supply. And rent is something that is paid over profit from the profit which we earn, which these resources have helped us to gain the profit. So we have three theories in this. First is the Ricardian theory of rent. We shall be studying each of the theory in detail. Then modern theory of rent, attributed mainly to John Robinson. In this theory, rent is earned by all factors of production. Here the concepts discussed are scarcity rent. Then rent as generalized surplus, difference between factors, actual earning and its transfer earnings. Quasi-rent, attributed to Marshall. In this, rent refers to short-run earnings of some factors of production because they are fixed in supply during the short run. Ricardian theory of rent. According to Ricardo, rent is that portion of the produce of the earth which is paid to the landlord for the use of original and indistributable powers of the soil. So, now what is rent? Rent is that portion of the produce of the earth which is paid to the landlord for the use of original and indestructible powers of the soil. Then, for greater understanding of the Ricardian model of rent formation, we will understand the various assumptions made by him. Now, what were the different assumptions which were made by Ricardo? Ricardo considers the supply of land as completely fixed, that is, perfectly inelastic in supply. Then, he does not take into account the various alternative uses to which land can put. He assumes the land to be used for growing a single composite crop on. He assumes that there is perfect competition in the market for land. He assumes that land differs in quality. There are various grades of land differing from each other in respect of fertility and location. These differences are differences in fertility lead to factor yielding rent, that is, superior or more fertile land yield in surplus due to their differential advantages in production over inferior or less fertile ones. Ricardo viewed rent as a differential surplus earned by more fertile plots of land in comparison with the less fertile plots of land. Therefore, Ricardian theory of rent is also called the differential theory of rent. So he has made certain assumptions. On basis of certain assumption, he has given his theory. He has assumed firstly that land is completely fixed, that is, perfectly inelastic in supply. And then he has assumed that it does not take alternative uses. It has a single consumption, that is, a single composite crop. That is, only a corn is being grown on that land. Then he assumes that there is a perfect competition. So these all assumptions don't actually come into reality, but still he has done his theory on basis of these assumptions. The emergence of differential rent in the Ricardian theory can be easily explained by imagining that a new island is discovered and some people come to settle there. There are only four plots of land, A, B, C, D, labeled in the order of their fertility. That is, A is the most fertile plot, B is inferior to A, and C is inferior to B, and D is the least fertile land. It is assumed that corn is being cultivated and that the same same doses of labor L and capital K are being used on these plots. When people first come to his island, they will take up the best grade land A for production of corn. So long as some of grade A land is yet lying idle, there will be no rent. Let the initial demand for corn be 100 quintals. And let us suppose cultivation of land A is sufficient to meet demand. But with the growth of population, as demand for food increases, say up to 170 quintals, the scarcity of land A is felt and inferior land B will be brought under cultivation. Now the cost of cultivation of land A and B is same. Yet land A yields 100 quintals of corn while B yields only 70 quintals. Therefore, land A releases a surplus of 30 quintals over the yield of land. B is a producer of surplus, or it is a rent claim by the owner of land. That is, it is surplus of superior land over inferior land. If, however, demand for food increases still further to say 220 quintals, land C will be brought under cultivation with the same amount of labor and capital. Land C yields 50 quintals of corn. Now, as compared to land C, land B yields a surplus of 20 quintals of corn, suppose 70 to 50, while land A yields a surplus of 50 quintals, that is 100 to 50. As population continues to increase, the demand for corn also increases and land D will also be brought under cultivation. If land D yields 30 quintals of corn, then land A yields a corn surplus of 70 quintals. Land B yields 40 quintals and land C also yields a surplus of 20 quintals. This land C, which did not get any rent previously, also earns rent when an inferior quality of land is brought under cultivation. Expressing the analysis in money terms, we consider rent as surplus over the cost of production. Let the cost of production, that is price of given amount of labor and capital, is equal to rupees 6000. Let the corn cost rupees 200 per quintal. Rent yielded by different plots of land can be shown as follows. So whatever we read just now, this is the example how it is described. So in this, see how land A, 200, price is 200 into 100, quantity 100, which is equal to TR, that is total rent is 20,000, total cost is 6,000. So TR minus TC is 14,000. Then similarly, B, we consider the price to be same, but the land yields only 70 quintals. Then we get 14,000 as the total rent. Then we get 6,000 total cost. So it is 8,000. So similarly, as the fertility of the land depends, and so the rent and other factors will keep on changing. Therefore, according to Ricardo, the more fertile land yields more and more rent as more and more of less fertile land is brought under cultivation. Ricardo describes the superior or more fertile land as intramarginal land, while less fertile land earning no rent is called as the marginal land. The marginal land's revenue just covers its cost of cultivation. And when still inferior land is brought under cultivation, the marginal land becomes intramarginal land and starts earning rent. Thus, differential rent or surplus is equal to yields of intramarginal land minus yield of marginal land. Differential rent can be diagrammatically represented as follows. So, here in rupees and thousand on the y-axis and on the x-axis grades of land. The cost of cultivation and the intramarginal or the marginal land and grades of land can be shown similarly. So, the Ricardian theory of rent can also be explained with the help of competitive market module of equilibrium of the different forms with different quantities of land. This can be illustrated as follows. So, in figure A, 4.8A represents the AC and the MC curve of the most fertile land. A, B, C and D represents those of the lands B, C and D. In the beginning, only land A is cultivated. OP1 is the market price of corn and E1 is the equilibrium point. MR is equal to rising MC. And OA1 of output is produced. Land A at this stage does not earn any rent as there is no surplus. Rent is the surplus revenue over cost. When the population increases and demand for corn rises, the price of corn increases to say OP2. Now land B will be cultivated and OB1 will be cultivated in land B. In land A, equilibrium shifts to E2 and OA2 is cultivated. Since AR is greater than AC, land A releases a surplus. This is the rent earned by the landlord of A. Similarly, when population increases further and demand for corn rises, its prices increases to OP3. Land C is also bought under cultivation and now land A earns greater surplus. Therefore, rent and land B also starts earning rent. And if price of corn rises to OP4 as a result of increase in demand due to rising population, then land D is also cultivated. Land A, B, C earn rent. A, B and C are intra-marginal lands while D is the no rent land is marginal land. For D, AR is equal to AC. Rent for land A is equal to P4, E4, P, FG. And rent for land B is equal to P4, FJ, K. And rent for land C is P4, L, M, N. So we can understand all these from these curves, how these curves have described each of the revenue and how the rent or the price can be described. And land D earns no rent. According to Ricardo, rent is price determined and not price determining. That is, corn is not high because a rent is paid, but a rent is paid because corn is high. According to Ricardo, rent is a differential surplus of revenue over cost. This implies that rent is not treated as an element of cost. Now, price is based on AC and AC does not include rent. Therefore, price does not depend on rent. Therefore, rent is not price determining. From the above analysis, it is clear that as price of corn rises, rent also rises. Therefore, rent depends upon price. So he has explained his theory that how rent and price are determined depending upon each other. As the crop increases, the rent also shall go on increasing over time. Criticism on Ricardian theory of rent. Now, what is the criticism that we have seen? Ricardo's views of the concept of rent as a payment made for the use of marginal and indestructible powers of soil is incorrect. It is difficult to ascertain what these original powers are and what are not. Moreover, in the modern era, one cannot claim anything to be indestructible. Ricardo assumed that land is cultivated in order of its fertility. That is, the most fertile land is cultivated first and the less fertile land followed by the least fertile land. There is no empirical evidence in economic history to support this thesis. In fact, it has been observed that the location is more significant rather than fertility in its selection of cultivation. The theory assumes perfect competition, which is unrealistic. In reality, if marginal land, no rent land does not exist, it is difficult to measure differential rent of intra-marginal land. According to Ricardo, rent is a differential surplus accruing to land alone because of differences in fertility. But according to modern economists, rent would arise even if land was homogeneous according to them. Any factor, not just land, would earn rent if there exists an inelastic supply of the factor. That is, if the supply of a particular factor is less than perfectly elastic. So, this was the theory, or these were the criticism which the Ricardo's theory got, because he had made certain unrealistic assumptions to his theory. Now, next modern theory of rent. The main propounder of the modern theory of rent is Mrs. Joan Robinson. This theory is based on three important propositions. Rent arises due to scarcity of land. Rent is generalized surplus earned by all factors. Rent as a surplus earned by a factor is measured with reference to transfer earnings of this factor in its prevailing employment. Scarcity rent. Here the determination of rent is explained in terms of the interaction of demand and supply forces. Rent is based on the scarcity of the availability of land. It is immaterial whether it is of superior or inferior or any other quantity. Rent emerges as if all plots of land are homogeneous if they are scarce in relation to demand. According to modern economists, in any period, whether long or short, the supply of land in existence is perfectly inelastic. Therefore, a rise in demand for land with the growth of population will intensify its relative scarcity. So, the price of land, that is rent, tends to rise further and further with the rise in demand. This is illustrated as follows. So, as we know that land is such a factor that cannot be increased or decreased according to the population. So, we have to adjust according to the land. We have to grow the crops and we have to manage with the population increase also. In the above figure, 4.9 SQ is the supply curve of land, perfectly inelastic, and D1 is the initial demand curve for land, and OR1 is the equilibrium rent determined, where demand equals supply. If however demand increases, the new demand curve is D2, and rent increases to OR2. Similarly, a further shift in demand curve to D3 results in rising to OR3. Thus, rent rises because of demand pressure and scarcity of land. That is, scarcity rent is demand determined. So means what? As the demand for the land increases, the rent also increases because it is a scarce mean of production for the farmers. Now next, let us understand rent as a generalized surplus. According to modern economists, rent is a generalized surplus. That is, rent is not peculiar to land alone. It can be earned by any factor of production which is scarce in relation to its demand. Scarcity means inelasticity of supply, and inelasticity of supply is not a peculiarity of land alone. Other factors of production like labor, capital and enterprise too are inelastic in supply, at least in the short period. Therefore, rent is a generalized surplus that can accrue to any factor of production. Then next we have measurement of rent with reference to transfer earnings. According to Mrs. Joan Robinson, the price which is necessary to retain a given unit of a factor in a certain industry may be called its transfer earnings. TES in fact are nothing but the opportunity cost of a factor, that is, what the factor could earn in its next best alternative use or employment is its TE. In order to retain a factor in its particular use, it must be paid at least equal to its opportunity cost or TE, that is what it could earn elsewhere. The TEs are the minimum supply price of a factor unit in a particular industry. So from this we can understand that in case if the land was not used for agriculture, it had some other best use. So if that best use could have done, what would be the price of that earning? So this is called transfer earning. The minimum supply price of a factor means the minimum payment which is necessary to induce him to continue to work in its present occupation. Therefore, rent is equal to reward of a factor in a particular industry minus the minimum supply price of that factor in this industry. Further, minimum supply price of a factor unit in a particular industry is equal to transfer earning. Economic rent is equal to current earning of a factor minus its TES. According to the modern theory of rent, rent as a surplus over TES depends on the elasticity of supply of the factor. Consider the case of factor having perfectly elastic supply, where TE is equal to zero, and the entire income of a surplus is treated as rent. In the case of land, it is a free gift of nature. Therefore, its supply is equal. Supply price is equal to zero, or TE is equal to zero. Therefore, the whole earnings are rent. Again, if the land has only a specific use and cannot be used elsewhere, then also its TE is equal to zero. Land, moreover, is perfectly inelastic in supply. Therefore, when demand for land increases, rent increases proportionately. Therefore, rent in the case of land remains completely a demand determined phenomenon. This can be illustrated as follows. So the below diagram shows how the if we consider it to be perfectly inelastic, then how the conditions shall change. In the above figure 4.10, given perfectly inelastic supply curve SQ and demand curve DD, equilibrium factor price is equal to OR and OQ is the number of factor units demanded and supplied. The total earnings of the factor is equal to OR PQ. Since TE is equal to zero, the entire income is a differential surplus treated as rent. When demand increases to D1, the factor price equals to OR1, and total earnings also rises to OR1 P1Q. Therefore, rent increases when demand increases. So, as the demand for the product increases, its rent also shall increase with the other factors. Consider the case of a factor with supply less than perfectly elastic. The supply curve in this case is upward sloping, implying that additional units of the factor will be supplied only at a higher price. Hence, TE, the minimum supply price, increases for each additional unit. This can be illustrated as follows. In the figure 4.11, if OJ units are supplied, LJ is the minimum supply price, or TE, and for OK units of supply, minimum supply price is equal to MK. When DD is the demand interacting with upward sloping supply curve, SS, OR is this a factor price, and total earnings are ORPQ. But TE is measured by the area below the SS curve is equal to OSPQ. Therefore, economic rent is equal to ORPQ minus OSPQ, which is equal to SRP. And if the demand curve shifts to D1, factor price increases to OR1. Total earnings is equal to OR1 P1Q1. TE is equal to OSP1Q1, economic rent is equal to OR1P1Q1 minus OSP1Q1, so is equal to SR1P1, higher rent. Therefore, rent is determined on the basis of demand. Consider the case of a factor having perfectly elastic supply. In this case, TE are the same as actual earnings, hence the rent is zero. This is depicted as follows. In the above figure 4.12, even if demand shifts to D1, supply is perfectly adjusted to the increase in demand at the same minimum supply price OS, so that the actual price also remains unchanged. Hence, though the total earnings of a factor rises, the TES also rise proportionately with the increasing employment of the factor. So rent, so as a surplus does not arise. Therefore, according to modern theory of rent, when the supply of the factor is perfectly elastic, its entire earnings are economic rent. When the supply of a factor is less than perfectly elastic, its total earnings include a part of economic rent. Greater the degree of inelasticity, greater is the element of economic rent. When the supply of the factor is perfectly elastic, its entire earnings are equal to TES. Therefore, there is no element of economic rent. Hence, a factor would earn economic rent only when its supply is less than perfectly elastic. So, with this we can understand that the rent depends upon the supply and demand of the product. Now, next, let us study about quasi-rent. The idea of quasi-rent was introduced by Alfred Marshall. It refers to the short-run earnings of some factors of production which may be fixed in the short run but not in the long run. These factors of production include capital such as machines and other man-made instruments, factors building ships, etc. Unlike land, though, these factors of production are fixed supply only in the short period. Their supply is elastic in the long run. In the short period, their supply is inelastic. Hence, when demand rises, their income increases, and when they earn a surplus, the surplus is temporary because their supply becomes elastic in the long run. Therefore, in the long run, when demand increases, supply increases and adjusts to the increase in demand. Hence, these factors do not earn any surplus in the long run. In a strict sense, the short-run surplus earned from the use of these factors cannot be regarded as rent. Although they look like rent due to its inelastic supply, therefore Marshall calls it quasi-rent, meaning just like rent. Thus, quasi-rent is a short-term temporary surplus earning of some factors. It refers to short-term extra income earned by a factor in excess of its normal. For example, where there is a sudden increase in the demand for a particular kind of skilled labor, its supply cannot be increased immediately. Therefore, the new increase in demand leads to a rise in the price of the skilled labor. The increase is price. This increase in prices can be termed as quasi-rent. However, in the long run, the supply of this skilled labor can expand consistently. The supply increases to match the demand, and the price comes down to its normal level. Therefore, the surplus earning disappears. Hence, quasi-rent is a short-run phenomenon. So, this quasi-rent is a short-run concept because in the long run, maybe these factors do not affect. Stoner and Hague have analyzed quasi-rent and say that in the short run, any return earned by the use of a machine in excess of its variable cost can be regarded as quasi-rent. Quasi-rent is equal to STR minus STV, where STR is the total revenue in short run and total variable cost in the long run. So from this given graph, we can understand how it is to be done. In the above figure 4.13, it can be seen that the firm will continue to remain in business in the short run as long run as it recovers its variable cost. Thus, the minimum supply price of the firm's output is the short run TVC, and any return in excess of this is a surplus, that is quasi-rent. At price OP1, equilibrium is at E1 and output Q1. TR is equal to OP1, E1, Q1, and therefore, hence, no surplus and no quasi-rent. Any increase in demand leads to an increase in price to OP2 at which OQ is produced. TR is equal to OP2, E2, Q2, and quasi-rent is equal to P2, E2, and AB. Any further increase in demand leads to increase in price to OP3 at which O3 is produced. TR is equal to OP3, E3, Q3, and quasi-rent is equal to P3, E3, CD. Any further increase in demand leads to increase in price or to OP4 at which OQ4 is produced. TR is equal to OP4 E4 Q4 and quasi rent is equal to P4 E4 Hg. Quasi rent is price determined and this thus a short run phenomenon. So today we have studied about rent, and in that we have studied three different concepts. First was the Ricardian theory, then we studied about quasi rent, and we have understood all these concepts. I hope you have all understood.